edition of Baker Donelson's 2015 Higher Education Webinar Series. We're glad you could join us today. My name is Dan Cohen, and I'm the chair of Baker Donelson's Higher Education team. Baker Donelson is an Am Law 100 law firm with over 650 attorneys in 19 offices. Among other practices, we have a team of experienced attorneys focusing on serving the legal needs of educational institutions across a broad spectrum of legal matters, including intellectual property and licensing, privacy and information security, healthcare and issues affecting medical academic programs, construction and public finance, labor and employment, and other unique issues affecting colleges like student discipline, sexual misconduct, and intercollegiate athletics. Each month, our higher ed attorneys will host a free webinar addressing timely topics across the spectrum. So please look for our webinar announcements in the coming months. And feel free to contact a member of our higher education team if you have any questions about our past programs, all of which are available on Baker Donelson's higher education website, or any other legal issue. Today, Wes Redmond and Eric Coleman will address legal issues and risks associated with employee classifications involving adjunct and part-time professors, independent contractors, interns, volunteers, and athletes. Wes Redmond is a Baker Donelson shareholder with 30 years of employment law experience. He assists clients daily in complying with the many state and federal laws that govern the employment relationship, and he represents employers in government investigations and litigates employment disputes on behalf of employers. His clients are in a number of industries, and he's represented and advised educational institutions in both employment matters and in student discipline matters. Wes is an AV-rated lawyer and is a frequent lecturer and author on employment issues. Eric Coleman is an associate in Baker Donelson's Birmingham office. He received his bachelor's degree from Auburn University and his law degree from the University of Alabama School of Law. Eric works on labor and employment matters, and as a former college athlete, Eric focuses a part of his practice on the intercollegiate athletics, including labor and employment issues that impact the ever-changing NCAA landscape. And with that, I will turn it over to Wes and Eric.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you, everyone, for attending today. This issue we're going to be talking about today is really one of the hottest issues that's going in the employment world now, which is classification of employees, or more correctly, the misclassification of employees and what can happen on that. I've lectured on this several times, but we've had some changes that have occurred recently that are fairly monumental. First, why? Why is this such a hot issue? Well, for example, you can see here that the United States Department of Labor has recovered $18 million in back pay for almost 20,000 employees who are wrongly classified as independent contractors. And that's just one agency, the DOL. And those mostly have been cases that involved people who were classified as independent contractors and therefore did not receive minimum wage or probably more correctly overtime payments. But also the government is very concerned about what they refer to as the tax gap. Both the United States and states that are having their treasuries that are being depleted, and one of the reasons that they say that occurs is because of the misclassification of employees and taxes not being paid on them. It's also impacting Social Security funding. And what we are finding and what we have been heard is that the agencies are actually talking to each other when they have found that there have been misclassification, which sort of doubles down on the potential liability for it. Several years ago, I know the IRS hired a number of new agents. I believe the number was in the thousands to investigate potential misclassifications. And they also, the Department of Labor, has given millions of dollars to various states who enter into agreements with them to try and find employers who have misclassified employees incorrectly. And for those of you, and I know it's all of you who are in the educational field, the educational field is not immune from this, as we'll see. Here's some of the myths that people have, and we'll talk about these some as we go through, which is that the worker really is the one who determines whether or not he or she is going to be an independent contractor, that the worker can sort of opt to be that. And that a person who actually works for more than one employer is always going to be an independent contractor, and that anyone that you refer to as a temporary worker is going to be automatically an independent contractor. Those are myths, which by definition means they are not always accurate, and here they are actually seldom accurate. One of the things that you always want to be aware of is what are the risks. So we'll talk first about what are the risks. The number one thing people think of, all right, fines under the tax laws. You treat it as an employee, as an independent contractor. You didn't take out taxes. Mr. Smith has disappeared, and the government says, well, you owe not only the unpaid taxes, unpaid Social Security, but you also own certain fines for it. And as you see, there could be personal liability for that. That's the worst risk most people think of, and they tend to think that's about the worst that can happen to them, but there's others. Unemployment benefits and fines for unpaid taxes to the state. One of the very first issues that I confronted on this was a company who we represented had employees and independent contractors basically doing the same thing. The Alabama Department of Labor showed up, and in Alabama you have to pay a certain percentage of the first $5,000 for unemployment, and they said for all these independent contractors, we think you owe unemployment benefits on them. You can have liability for failure to obtain workers' compensation coverage, because you usually don't obtain workers' comp coverage for your independent contractors, but in most states you might find that you have to pay double an amount. You certainly have probably not provided benefits, so there's can be some ERISA to them. You could be in violation of the immigration laws for failing to fill out the I-9s on those individuals and get the employment authorization verification. You may violate your state's E-Verify requirement, which Alabama has a new immigration law. It passed several years ago. It got a lot of press, and part of that is you have to E-Verify all of your employees. And failure to do that can have some pretty severe penalties. In the state of Alabama, if you have three violations, you might actually be out of business. You can have liability under the Affordable Care Act that you're not aware of, because you probably have not provided health insurance for your independent contractors, but they really are employees, and they should have been counted to determine if you had the 50 full-time equivalents. You might be liable for unpaid wages to them, and particularly overtime. A lot of cases involving the cable installation field and some others where people have sued for overtime, claiming that they were treated as independent contractors so they didn't get paid any overtime, which, like the tax laws, can only have some personal liability, but it can result in double damages. You're certainly going to be in violation of certain record-keeping requirements under the Fair Labor Standards Act and under Title VII. You may lose some of your intellectual property rights because you probably didn't have independent contractors enter into the right kind of agreements, and you may have some unexpected liability to the third parties. Normally, you're not liable for the torts of independent contractors, but you are of employees. So as you can see, there can be some pretty serious risk that can come with misclassifying employees as independent contractors when they should, in fact, have been classified as employees. Oh, here's some others. They keep coming. You may find out unexpectedly that the federal and state anti-discrimination laws apply to someone that you treat as an independent contractor, but really they're an employee. You may have had multiple violations of the Family and Medical Leave Act for failing to treat individuals as employees, and therefore you've stayed under the 50 employee requirement. And you could have breach of contract claims for independent contractors who you fire because they were not provided the at-will employment disclaimer. I could probably spend the whole hour talking about the risk. As you can see, they are many and varied, and some of those are pretty serious. So we'll talk about here sort of, you know, as we already have talked about, here's our roadmap for today. What happens if I improperly classify someone? Who can be an independent contractor? Here's some questions about it. If I make them an independent contractor, I don't have to worry about the Affordable Care Act, or if I send them a 1099, and what could I do to make sure I don't improperly classify someone as one? There are a number of tests that are out there for determining what is an independent contractor. Most states have what they call the common law agency test, who controls it. The DOL had for years what it called the economics reality test. The IRS uses a 20-factor test. Every agency and group and every statute is going to have a little bit of a different test as to what qualifies as an independent contractor. And this is sort of the common law rule, you know, if the person has the right to control and direct the results and services and means, then that would be an employer-employee relationship. If they don't, then it would not be. And we used to, for the first 28 years of when I practiced, we sort of lived by the common law rule and figured every other test was just trying to formulate this, but there have been some significant changes. Particularly July 15th of this year, the Department of Labor put out a memorandum. And this first part, this first statement here, this was the email I sent out to some of our lawyers who I was working on some independent contractor issues with. And I put in there, Department of Labor sounds the death knell for independent contractors. And I told them it's a little bit of hyperbole, but not much. And then I saw someone who I have a lot of respect for that wrote this article that said, what do independent contractors and dodo birds have in common? Which apparently they are both now extinct, at least as far as the Department of Labor is concerned. This was the Department of Labor's interpretation. It has a long title, but it basically deals with misclassification, where the administrator said he was providing some additional guidance. They gave some, they were saying this really doesn't change anything. This is just part of our ongoing efforts. But they said very clearly in there that most individuals who are classified as either independent contractors, volunteers, owners, had a number of definitions. In our mind, they are really employees. And we'll talk about the new test that he sort of was advocating, but it really comes down to this. Is this individual really in business for him or herself? Are they acting as a business owner? And all the tests will sort of go to that. To me, what also was very telling about the breadth of what the Department of Labor was saying is they made it clear that in all of their statutes, they used the broadest term possible, and it was borrowed from some state laws that were designed to allow the state agencies to have jurisdiction over people who were basically engaging in illegal child labor. So that sort of tells you how serious they were about that and what the breadth of that is, because they were it's based on state laws that were designed to prevent illegal child labor. You know, what has changed? You know, the administrator says it really doesn't change it. It's just another installment going back to 2010. And on September 2011, the Department of Labor and IRS entered into an agreement to coordinate their efforts. Labor departments in 25 states have entered similar memorandum, in which my state, Alabama, is one, and you'll see the 25 that are there. This is what the DOL said back in 2010. Misclassification employees is a serious problem, not only because the misclassified employees are denied access to benefits, but also it's losses to the Treasury and Social Security and Medicare. So they began this initiative about 5 years ago. But they have now, things have changed, because their new emphasis is now on whether the person has economic dependence. And you'll see the bold statement, most workers are employees. So we know the DOL is going to be aggressively looking at this issue of independent contractors. Now, the courts don't necessarily have to agree with the Department of Labor's new interpretation, but I will tell you, you know, a lot of the courts have, in fact, been in agreement with a lot in the labor area that this current administration has done. So we expect that's going to be a pretty powerful tool for the plaintiff's lawyers. And you know, whenever you're looking at whatever test it is, this idea that there's an economic dependence analysis. That's sort of the overarching consideration. That's going to be the trump card that's really going to decide everything. So let's look very quickly. I don't want to spend a lot of time on this because I want to talk directly about some of the educational issues and how they're impacted by this. But you start out with the economics reality test. The first part of the test, is it an integral part of the employer's business? Is it the core work that we do? If you have independent contractors doing your core work, chances are that you're going to at least fail this test. You know, you see here in a construction company, framers, there was a recent case involving flaggers that were treated as independent contractors that I wrote about, where they said that's an integral part of what the company does. But a software developer who comes in to design software on a one project basis for a construction company may be able to be classified as an independent contractor. Does the worker's skill affect their opportunity for profit or loss? Are they really in business for themselves? Can they hire someone else? Can they purchase materials? Do they advertise? That's what independent contractors do. Employees, by contrast, don't have this. And the opportunity to earn more or less really just depends upon the amount of work that the employer provides them, not on any of their managerial skills. How does the worker's investment compare to the employer's? Now, all employees make some investment in their work. Independent contractors typically are making the kind of capital investments that they're operating as independent businesses. They're buying equipment. They're buying, in the construction area, they're buying trucks. Or they're perhaps buying computers. That's the type of investment that the worker has to have in order to be treated as an independent contractor. Does the work performed require special skill and initiative? This one has not been as helpful for individuals who want to be classified as independent contractors as it might seem. It's not talking about the technical skills. They're talking about the skills that allow them to operate as an economically independent business. So the fact that you might be really good at what you do or very skilled at what you do is not going to be a factor indicating that you are an independent contractor as opposed to an employee. Is the relationship permanent or indefinite? True independent contractors usually don't stay in that position for an extended period of time. Typically, they're hired on a project or for a short or time period, which leads to one of the myths that we talked about, which is that if you're temporary, you must be an independent contractor. No, that's only one criteria. You know, an exclusive independent contractor relationship lasting for years is a common misclassification red flag. And short duration seasonal work may be a indication, but that doesn't necessarily by itself even equal to an independent contractor relationship. What is the nature and degree of the employer's control? Historically, everyone thought that was really the most important factor. The DOL has really almost thrown out the control test and replaced it with the new economic dependence test. You know, you must control the meaningful aspects of the work such that you are truly in business for yourself. That's what it takes in order to be treated as an independent contractor. Here's a couple of red flags, and I got this first from some of my tax guys. It says, if you fail these, you really need to reconsider whether you're going to treat someone as an independent contractor. Do you have employees perform essentially the same duties as your independent contractors? Back to the example I gave you of when the Alabama Department of Labor showed up wanting unemployment, we had employees who were doing the same thing as independent contractors. The client did. And have you classified the independent contractor as an employee in the past while she was performing essentially the same task as now? I get that question a lot. You know, they're leaving. We've eliminated their job, but we really want them to come back and work for us, but we're going to do it as an independent contractor. That's a problem. Are they doing now as an independent contractor exactly what they did as an employee? Those are two very specific red flags? Those ought to be the first two questions that you ask. This is the IRS, the IRS's 20-factor test, in which all 20 factors are considered. We're not going to go through all of them, but I think you'll sort of see here as to whether, how the IRS 20-factor test compares to the new DOL's test. I would say the new DOL test is probably stricter, which is why people are saying that you really should not expect to be able to have an independent contractor relationship with an individual anymore under the DOL test. The 20-factor test, supposedly no one is more important than the other, and it's really just sort of, it's a very difficult test to administer as a practical matter, to know which ones weigh more heavily. But we do know that the DOL and the IRS are talking. And so if you're going to fail the DOL test, you might very well think about you're going to have a tough time meeting the IRS 20-factor test. There's sort of three control areas. Is there behavioral control? Is there financial control? And what's the relationship of the parties? That's sort of, if you take those, the IRS's test, that's sort of the three areas that they exist in. So here's some questions. I think I've actually gotten all of these at one point in time. Employer doesn't want to pay for the Affordable Care Act, says, can I just classify them as independent contractors to avoid the ACA? And no, the answer clearly is no, you cannot do that. If they actually can meet the now very difficult, almost impossible test of being an independent contractor, then you can, but you can't just decide to classify them to avoid the ACA. Neither can you do it to avoid liability under Title VII of the Family Medical Leave Act. And it's not going to be governed by how you decide to classify them. If you send them a 1099 and don't withhold payroll taxes, that does not make them an independent contractor. It might be one factor, but it's going to be a very low-level factor in terms of whether or not they're an independent contractor. You're really going to have to meet the DOL's economic dependence test or the IRS's test. So let's talk specifically about how this works in the educational system. And I got interested in this. Actually, how I got interested, this was one of my clients, one of my partners wanted me to look up the issue of whether or not a substitute doctor who filled in could be treated as an independent contractor. As an analogy, I started looking at substitute teacher test cases. And then I started looking at the IRS about how they treated adjunct professors and things of that sort. And I really was surprised at how they decided those. So first thing that you look at here, the first issue is their behavioral control. What type of instruction is given? And the things the IRS look at here is, all right, does the school determine the course? Does the school determine the textbooks that are being given? Well, think about the degree of instruction. Again, are they determining when and where the courses are? Is the school enrolling the students? Is there an evaluation system? Are the professors being subject to evaluation? Are they subject to observation? And then the training, not a lot of cases about actually training, but there are cases that talk about are they required to, and are the professors required to, and are they instructed on the school's rules and regulations. The next one, financial control. Does the university have the right to control the economic aspects? Who makes the investment? Is the school providing an office? Are they providing a computer? Are they providing internet? Are they providing the textbooks? Are there expenses that the professor has to pay for? Is there an opportunity for profit or loss, which is going to be an important one to the Department of Labor, other than what they're just being paid on an hourly rate for teaching this class or on a per class rate? Do they have any opportunity to make additional profit or loss? Services available to the market. One of the issues in evaluate whether someone is an independent contractor is, okay, are they working for one person or for others? The IRS particularly, it hasn't seemed to matter to them if the professors have other jobs or not. And then they look at how they are being paid. You know, are they being paid by the hour? Is it a salary? And then they look at the relationship of the parties. How the university and the workers, is there a written contract? Do they consider themselves as employees? And do they treat them like employees? Do they get employee benefits? And I'll tell you, if you provide employee benefits to them, very, very good chance they're going to be treated as employees and not independent contractors. The permanency of the relationship, has this been going on for years? Or are they just teaching a class here and there? And then finally, is it the regular activity of the business? I mean, is it a core course that they are teaching, or are they teaching something that's not necessarily part of their core course? I wanted to talk about give you some specific examples, and these all come from the IRS rulings. And I'm going to try to run through these quickly. But in one instance, the tax court considered an adjunct professor who taught online courses. Taught about 4 to 12 online courses per year, but he was teaching the university's normal curriculum. The university provided the software and server space, enrolled students, set the course dates and matters, although the taxpayer, the professor, set his own hours and provided his own computer and internet connection and office space, and determined the specifics of what he was going to teach. The tax court still found that the professor was an employee there. And another one, the court found that a part-time adjunct professor was an employee. He was a lecturer and instructor for two universities and was hired on a class-by-class basis, but the university had the authority to determine what classes were taught, when they would be taught, where they would be taught. They found the professor really had no investment in the work facilities, no opportunity for profit or loss. He had particular hours he was to teach, and he was paid on an hourly basis and could be terminated before the end of the school year. So they considered him as an employee. In another instance, the tax court considered about an adjunct professor who was teaching in engineering courses. The professor was primarily employed as an engineer, but taught several courses on a semester-by-semester basis. The college required all adjunct professors to use the same textbooks and the same syllabus. The college observed the professor for his performance. Court there found that he was, in fact, an employee and not an independent contractor. Private college hired lawyers from the community to teach law classes, which was part of the regular curriculum for the school year. They found that the contracts for their services were for the regular business of the college, and they were not engaged in the independent calling, that the college, because it determined what was going to be taught, the classes, that they had the right to control and direct the instructors, sufficient to show that there was an employer-employee relationship. Last one of these, let's see, there was another one here. College retained an instructor to teach an art class for 3 hours. He performed similar services for other colleges. IRS found he was not engaged in an independent business. His services were integral to the business of the college. He did not incur the usual business risk of a bona fide business, had little investment, and his service was continuous, and that they found that they could not fire him, they could just refuse to hire him in the future. At a private law school, adjunct faculty at the law school, they had contracts to teach specific courses. The payments were based on their experience and complexity. The adjuncts were required to perform the service personally or to obtain a substitute who was approved by the university. Still found there that they were, in fact, employees instead of independent contractors. In fact, what we find is the IRS really always finds that professors are employees. And it doesn't matter what title you give them, part-time, adjunct, class by class, online, etc. Now, a lot of people have argued, but they've not gotten any far by saying, well, teaching by itself has some inherent independence. But the IRS has actually turned that argument around and said, yes, the nature of teaching has inherent independence, so that is not sufficient to establish lack of control. The fact that you're not in there directing how they teach every day, whether they call on students, when they give exams, that kind of independence is just inherent in the nature of the business. So they have found that's not sufficient to establish lack of control. The one exception, there have been a couple where if you're teaching a course that is outside of the normal curriculum of the university or college. For instance, I think Temple University had sponsored a criminal justice training program for police officers, not part of their regular curriculum, not offered for college credit. And so a part-time vocational instructor who taught the police officers was there. They found it was a very close call, but they found that he could be treated as an independent contractor and not an employee of Temple University. I think the only other instance that I've seen is the School of Business Administration at the University of Michigan had taught seminars for business executives through its Executive Education Center. Again, not for course credit, not part of the core curriculum. And so they found there that those were independent contractors. But if you have professors who are teaching the core curriculum, what the school is there for, the IRS, it appears, is almost always going to find that those individuals are employees of the school and not independent contractors, regardless of what their regular full-time job may be, regardless of whether they're teaching at other schools. You may have heard, these are some of the more famous independent contractor cases, Uber and FedEx, particularly out in California. Particularly, they have found that the Uber drivers are employees of Uber. If you know anything about their business model, this is pushing it out there some, saying that those drivers are, in fact, employees. And FedEx has had a couple of pretty substantial cases where they found that the FedEx drivers were employees of FedEx and not the independent contractors. And we were talking about the risk. I read one article, and, of course, for FedEx, I think it was $1 billion issue, that misclassification could be a Sarbanes-Oxley issue for your CFO and your CEO. How to avoid? How can you avoid these independent contractor problems? Well, first, if you're going to have independent contractors, you want to have a well-drafted contract with the individual that talks about that they'll pay for their expenses, that tells them that they will control the means and the methods by which things are done, that they are not displacing other employees. There's some language that you can use that at least can make it sound as if it's an independent contractor relationship. Although one of the things we're advising now is if you call it an independent contractor agreement, it is going to be subject to scrutiny. So he said call it something else. Call it a vendor agreement. Just call it anything else other than an independent contractor. And again, you want to use specific language to convey the intent that they're not going to be treated as employees, that they're not eligible for employee benefits and things of that sort. Instead of just paying them, you want to get an invoice, and you want to use an EIN. Paying an independent contractor or subcontractor or vendor, whatever you want to call them, and using their social security number is going to be subject to scrutiny. That's going to be an indication that they are an employee. Interesting, had a question come up last night. Somebody calls, said we have a client who has a subcontractor. They're just using his social security number, and we now find out he has employees. Well, they may find out that not only is that subcontractor their employee, but his employees are their employees too. Think about the amount of control you have over that person. You know, if you're telling them what to do, your supervisors are telling them what to do, they're probably going to be employees. And this last one, I might should put this one at the top. Hire incorporated entities, not individuals, whenever you can. An independent contractor agreement with an individual was risky before July 15th. Now that after the Department of Labor's, they probably have pretty much put the death knell on the idea of independent contractors with individuals. And then require people who are independent contractors to have a business license. Remember the case I started out telling you about when the Department of Labor, where they came down on, where they made the determination was, if any of these workers have a business license, we will treat them as an independent contractor. So some factors to keep in mind, the employer has the burden to prove the classification is right. If it's close, treat them as workers. Treat the workers as employees. And there's some more about some of the penalties again. The value of the written agreements, as we talked about, they can help define the relationship and at least avoid some confusion between the parties as to how they're supposed to be treated. And it can, an accurate agreement can assist you, but it will not control. It's what the worker actually did. So the agreements must be accurate. Conduct a self-audit soon. Don't wait for an investigation. Consider the administrator's new interpretation. Get your counsel to be involved so you can maintain some attorney-client privilege, and immediately reclassify those who present a close question. I'm now going to turn over and let Eric talk about interns and athletes.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Eric Coleman, and I'll be taking a few minutes this afternoon to discuss some of the legal issues involving interns and athletes. First, we're going to start off with interns and whether or not interns are classified as employees or if they are, in fact, interns. If you take just a random Google search today, you'll get over 3,000 hits under the search unpaid intern. And they'll vary from unpaid intern jobs to discussions on whether or not unpaid interns are ethical or legal, a wide variety of different hits. And one that I came across was this kind of spat between Fox News and the New York Times. The New York Times has published a lot of editorials regarding unpaid internships, and pretty much they're against them in most of the editorials, yet on their job website they have two posted, was back in March of 2014, they had two unpaid internship job openings posted, and Fox News kind of hit them over the head with it, saying you're crusading to end unpaid internships, yet you're still hiring them. So I thought that was one of the very interesting hits that I got in my Google searching. So why is all this important? From a employer standpoint, it's important because a lot of young, millennials are suing and trying to get wages for their work as unpaid internships. From a higher ed standpoint, it's important because many universities, at least I know when I was in school, which wasn't too long ago, unpaid internships or internships were a requirement for a lot of degree programs. And if employers stop offering these unpaid internships or stop offering internships just because they can't afford to pay interns, that affects the higher ed aspect of the internship. And also, plaintiff lawyers are taking a stab at any and every unpaid intern case that they can. Another one of the Google finds that I came across was if you search unpaid internship, the first thing that comes up is this website, www.unpaidinternslawsuit.com. And it's pretty much a website hosted by a plaintiff's law firm, you know, who's trying to bring any unpaid internship case they can. They're trying to bring in plaintiffs to potentially sue to collect wages. Now, this all, one of the most notable cases in this area is known as the Black Swan case. It's a 2013 case from a federal district court in New York in which the court ruled that Fox Searchlight Pictures had violated the federal wage and hour law when it employed two unpaid interns on the set of the Black Swan movie. Now, in the lower court decision, they relied on the Department of Labor's six-part test in ruling that the unpaid interns were in fact employees. Now, the Department of Labor put out this six-part test, and it states that you must meet all six parts to be considered interned. The internship is similar to training that will be given in an educational environment. The internship experience is for the benefit of the intern, not necessarily the benefit of the employer. The intern does not displace regular employees, but works with the employees in a learning environment, not necessarily to provide work, more so to learn about the field that they're in. The employer derives no immediate advantage from the activities of the intern. The intern is not necessarily entitled to a job at the conclusion of the internship, and the employer and the intern understand that the intern is not entitled to wages for the time spent on the internship. Now, this test, like I said, is the Department of Labor test, and it comes from an old case from 1947, which was Walling v. Portland Terminal Company. And that case involved railroad brakemen trainees. And it just as it sounds, it has nothing to do with interns in the higher ed setting. And this is what this actually resulted in it being overturned by the Second Circuit. The Second Circuit disagreed with the lower court, stating that all the Department of Labor has done is interpreted a 1947 case and taken six factors that the Supreme Court applied to railroad brakemen and then tried to formulate that into a test for internships. And according to the Second Circuit, the Department of Labor, while it is qualified to interpret its own rules and regulations, it's not necessarily qualified to interpret judicial opinions, i.e. the Supreme Court case of Portland. So the Second Circuit came up with a seven-factor test, which is non-exhaustive, and calls for a balancing of the different factors. And these seven factors are understanding of expectation of compensation, training similar to that which will be given in an educational environment. The internship is tied to the intern's formal education program, accommodation of the intern's academic commitment. In that aspect, they're referring to when the internship takes place. Is it during the academic year? Is it over the summer, in the break between the spring and fall semester? How does it accommodate and take into account the intern's academic commitment? The internship duration is limited to a period of beneficial learning, so it's not an extended internship where the intern is just there working, and not learning anything new. He's now providing a service to the employer at the employer's benefit and no longer at the benefit of the intern learning on the job. The work complements rather than displaces the work of paid employees, and no entitlement to a paid job when the internship precludes. This is considered, has been coined as the primary beneficiary test, and it focuses on what the intern receives in exchange for his work, which is similar to the factors that the Department of Labor pulled from the Portland Terminal case, but it also of course, the flexibility to examine the economic reality as it exists between the intern and the employer. Who's really getting the benefit of this relationship? Is it the intern getting an educational benefit to add to his overall academic experience, or is it the employer getting free labor? In addition, I'm not quite sure how to go back, but I want to also note before we move on to student athletes that the 11th Circuit also recently adopted this primary beneficiary test in the case of graduate nurses, nurse anesthetist, I think that's how it's pronounced correctly, where they were, as a part of their curriculum, they had to perform clinical hours. And this was counting towards their academic experience, and they were, and it's similar to the unpaid internship. And in that case, the court also adopted the Second Circuit seven-factor primary beneficiary test, as opposed to the Department of Labor's six-part test. So let's move on to student athletes. Now, this is one of my favorite areas of law. I'm a former Auburn football player. I was a walk-on, so I wasn't one of the glory guys, but, you know, still a great experience altogether. And so the issues with student athletes is close to my heart, so to speak. And two cases that are currently in the news, and I'm sure most of you probably have heard about or been told about to some extent. The first one is the Northwestern University football team trying to unionize. Unfortunately for the football players, the National Labor Relations Board declined their efforts to unionize, but they didn't necessarily, they declined it based off jurisdiction. They stated that they did not have jurisdiction to hear the case. They also stated that it would not effectuate the policies of the National Labor Relations Act to assert jurisdiction in the case, even if we assume without deciding that the Grant A scholarship players are employees. The crux of the board's argument were based on the fact that they only have jurisdiction over private universities, and only 17 of 128 universities are of 128 Division I universities are private. So they would be asserting jurisdiction over one team's case or one university's case, i.e. the Northwestern football players, but yet the NCAA is a massive body that incorporates a lot more universities. So they pretty much said, we're going to punt this issue because we don't want to disrupt the labor landscape by holding jurisdiction and deciding this issue in favor of one university when it will have ramifications across a wide spectrum of the entire NCAA. Additionally, in that decision, they took note that many strides have been made within the NCAA over the course of the last few years, including the recent reforms that include full four-year scholarships as opposed to the one-year renewable scholarships, and the recent cost of attendance stipends that went into effect this year. So they basically stated that the landscape is changing. The universities are recognizing that this is somewhat of an issue, and it is presenting constant debate. But at the same, on the same token, the universities are taking the lead on this, and NCAA is taking the lead on this and trying to change the practices and make it put them on a fair playing field. And the second notable case is that of Anderson v. the NCAA. Now, this case comes out of the Southern District of Indiana. Originally, The suit was, some of you may know it as SACOS, which is the original named plaintiff. It's Samantha SACOS. She was a former University of Houston woman soccer player. And the case, she basically alleged that NCAA athletes are temporary employees and are entitled to be paid at least the federal minimum wage and overtime under the Fair Labor Standards Act. Recently, the case has kind of been has shifted a little bit. So SACOS is no longer the lead plaintiff on the case, and this is because all the public universities that were former defendants were voluntarily dismissed because of immunity issues or potential immunity challenges. So involved, included in that group was the University of Houston, where Samantha Sakos played her college soccer. So they removed her, and in her place, they put in Lauren Anderson, Gillian Berger, and Taylor Henning, who are all former track athletes at the University of Pennsylvania. Now, this case is kind of in limbo at this stage. The class has not been certified yet, and actually conditional certification has been pushed back now until March of 2016. I was hoping that it was originally the deadline for the responsive briefs was this week, well, last week, the 16th, but in my last searches, it looks like they pushed it out all the way until March of 2016. But at this time, the motions to dismiss are pending. So there's a chance if the court grants the defendant's motions to dismiss that this thing could go away altogether. However, at this point, it's kind of in limbo and something that I think universities should keep an eye out on and just see how it develops over the next year or so. And with that, I'm going to hand it back over to Wes to discuss some volunteer issues with you.
Thank you, Eric. A couple of follow-ups to what you said, and I meant to send this to you. Just yesterday, two new class actions filed against Michael Kors and Versace, claiming that they misclassified employees as interns to avoid having to pay them. One last issue I want to talk about very quickly was just volunteers and how the Department of Labor feels about volunteers, which seems contrary to the spirit of volunteerism that we think is a good thing to have. I happen to be able to hear the solicitor for the Department of Labor, who's the chief lawyer, and apparently one of the issues they are looking at is this issue of volunteers who instead should be treated as employees, such as, and I think she gave the example, such as those who volunteer to raise money for the band or volunteer to raise money for the sports teams. I recently saw that the Department of Labor has taken the position that if you go to your local grocery store and you see those people who are bagging and carrying your bags out to your car for tips, the Department of Labor has taken the position that those people really should be employees. So the Department of Labor takes a very dim view on the ideas of volunteers and instead really wants to treat them all as if they are employees. So that sort of tells you where the Department of Labor falls on that. I think we are just about out of time. We actually have a few more minutes left. I was telling Eric earlier that I recently was asked to look at an issue where a couple of these intersected. Someone who was using paid interns but treating them as independent contractors. So sometimes you see that these things sort of dissect and converge together. But what you really see with this idea of independent contractors, interns, volunteers, it really is a move by the Department of Labor, particularly with the IRS not far behind, of trying to have as many individuals as they can classified as employees because they want to get the tax revenue and also because they take the position that some of these people, they're not getting the benefits that they should be getting as employees or basically being mistreated. And the intern or volunteers are not even getting paid minimum wage. The company's not keeping records. They're not getting overtime. They're not getting the benefits that come with that. So what we really see is a push that is coming from the Department of Labor and the IRS to try and treat as many people as they can by employees. And it also is filtering down to the state agencies too, where, for instance, the Alabama Department of Labor and I'm sure, and the identical agency in other states are looking to obtain money for their unemployment benefits and and to increase their tax base. All right. I think that's all that we have. Eric, anything else to add?
Just a question.
Yes. Does anyone have, if anyone has any questions, I haven't seen any come across yet. But if anyone has any questions, we have a minute or so, we'd be happy to answer them.
And, of course, you can feel free to contact Wes or Eric with any questions afterwards as well, where we will provide their contact information along with the webinar information, which will be posted on Baker Donelson's Higher Ed website.
Yes, we would love to hear any questions anyone has. Certainly that would help us as we're going through this. All right. Thank you to everyone for attending. I hope this was helpful to you. This idea of independent contractors and interns, these are sort of the hottest issues going. I get a number of publications, and I'm always hearing about these new intern cases being filed or these cases being filed by people who claim, well, I was classified as an independent contractor, but that means I didn't get my benefits, I didn't get workers' comp, I didn't get overtime pay. So these are pretty important issues now, and hopefully what you saw from the – and all the cases I talked about, those are all IRS cases, which seems to have at least objectively a more lenient standard in determining who's going to be an independent contractor. In other words, the IRS may be more likely to find they're an independent contractor, but the results do not seem to indicate that. The results seem to indicate that they are sort of taking the same position that the Department of Labor is, which is that except for in some very, very specific, very narrow circumstances, we're pretty much going to find that all of your professors and employees are going to be, or your professors and your workers are going to be employees and not independent contractors. All right. Again, thanks to everyone.
Thank you.